Okay, so we'll be doing the heat balance for a chemical source. So you have Z, from Z0 to ZL, you have the catalytic portion. The other portions are where you don't have the catalyst. So the heat reaction, the chemical reaction that generates heat will be only in this layer. So we can assume this to be a black flow due to the particles here. So the velocity should be constant. And you don't expect a velocity profile like the previous ones. In addition to that, let's say that the cylinder, this is a cylinder with a radius of R, and you are considering a small section of delta Z, which is this one. Let's take this as delta Z, and then your rate of heat inwards would be pi R square. So I can just take this as Q ZZ. I'm sorry about that. Here you'll be taking the total energy. It's not just heat, so just E in and this is E out. It's positive, negative, and finally the total energy that is being generated due to the reaction. You can just take the volume. This is pi R square into delta Z into the generation term SC. Okay, now here what can be done is you know that you can divide the whole equation by pi R square. Sorry, by pi r square z delta z, and what you will get is E in minus E out divided by delta z is equal to, and this is just z, and this is z plus delta z plus sc equal to 0. You bring this to the right hand side, and considering that delta z is almost tending to 0, you can just take d of E and d of z is equal to SE. Okay, so this is the first part. Now let's see how you can write ES. E is the total energy. That's basically your rho V square plus your rho H cap into V plus rho dot V plus Q. This is the conduction energy. Now here you know that velocity only in the V is equal to Z direction, not equal to 0. V in the x and V in the y is equal to 0. So substituting these values, you get V z square, V z plus rho. This can be taken as Cp t minus t0, V z plus t0 minus V z, Vz plus, again you have the cap here, this is h0, V z plus tau, you already know it is minus nu t V z by dz plus q, which can be taken as minus dt by dz. Now here, what are the terms that we actually can consider? And this whole will be differentiated by the differential of this. So this term is constant at z and z plus delta z. So you have to consider that is also constant, is also constant. Here you know that there is no variation of dz with z, so you can take this as also 0. Now at this term, when you are doing differential of this, when you take differential of dz, that term will go to 0, and then what you still have is a t term. So you can just write that on the top, and this will be as delta t delta z. This is rho Cp V0 minus kdt, sorry, that's square is equal to SE. Now once you reach this equation, this is the basic solution for this. And now we can introduce other terms such as boundary coefficients, sorry, boundary conditions, and also see how we can eliminate the remaining terms. Okay, so we'll just move this to the other side. This is rho Cp V0 dt by dz is equal to k effective dv square by dz square plus sc. Now what are the boundaries we have? So we can say when z is less than 0 is the first, and then z is greater than 0, greater than L, and then finally z is above L. So at this point, you know rho Cp V0 dt1 by dz is just equal to the k effective d square t1 dz square, because there's no generation term. And the second case you have Cp V0 dT2 by dz. This k effective is equal to d square T2 dz whole square plus Sc f theta, and that theta will be explained in the next part of the problem. And here finally on the third zone, again it's similar to the first. So f k effective is equal to v square, because again there's no generation. So these are the three zones. What are the boundary conditions that you have? So the first boundary condition is that z is equal to minus infinity, t is equal to t1, and z is equal to 0, we have t is equal to t2, and dz is equal to 0, you also know k effective dt1 by dz, because what goes in must come out, right? D square theta dz square. I'm sorry about that, you don't need square here. Yeah, and finally, when it is above, that z is equal to L, you can have t2 is equal to t3, and similarly at z is equal to L, k effective dt2 by dz is equal to k effective dt by dz. The third and last, you have that z is equal to infinity, t2 is just equal to a finite value. Okay, so you have this all boundary conditions, and using these boundary conditions, let's introduce the dimensional axial coordinate that will help us to solve this. Let's say z is equal to z by L, and you have a chemical source N is equal to C SL phi Cp V0 T1 minus T0, then we can just rewrite the zones as z is d theta by dz is equal to 0, 0 to z to 1 is equal to d theta by dz is equal to nf, and you already know the value of n, z raised to 1 is equal to d theta by dz by 0. So now you have made this into these three. Now let's just, at z is equal to minus infinity, you know already t is equal to t1, or theta is equal to 1, z is equal to 0, you know theta 1 is equal to theta 2, and finally at z is equal to 1, theta 2 is equal to theta 3. So using these three boundary conditions, you can solve the dimensional part of the problem, and what you get finally is in zone 1, theta 1 is equal to 1, that means it's a constant, and here from theta 1 to theta 2, 1 by f theta d theta is equal to nz, where the value of n was given 4, and finally in zone 3 you have theta 3 is equal to theta 3 at z is equal to 1. So these will be the different zones, and if you're looking at the temperature profile, it looks something like this. You will first have the temperature going constant. So you have constant temperature. From this point, depending on n, can have different variation in temperature. But once it reaches again zone 3, it's again stable, and this is on the dimensional axial coordinate, where z is equal to zl and theta is nothing but t minus t0 by t1 minus t0, which is why theta becomes 1 at z is equal to 0, because t is equal to t1, and you just have to make it that way. So you have your theta initially being 1, and then based on the reaction it changes and finally reaches again. So this would be n1, this would be n2, this is n, this would be minus 1. Okay, so this is how you solve for the chemical reaction heat source.